So thank you very much for the invitation. It's a great honor to speak, to give a talk for Kashiwara Sensei's 70th birthday. Also, I would like to say that I was very pleased, but also a little frightened when I got the invitation, because for me it's difficult to understand the connection between my work and the work of Kashiwara Sensei. So I went to my main collaborator, who is Akio Tamagawa, working at RIMS, and I told him, it's great, I will have to give a talk for Professor Kashiwara, but I'm not sure about what I should talk. And he paused for a while, and after a while he said, well, you know, Professor Kashiwara understands everything, so you shouldn't care too much about the topic of the talk. So in the end, as I think the mathematical spectrum of the audience is really wide, I decided to try and give a kind of survey talk of how to use in a systematic way, Galois representation to study some problem in arithmetic geometry. So first of all, I would just like to recall briefly what arithmetic geometry is. So in algebraic geometry, the original problem is to solve systems of polynomial equations with coefficients in a field K. And what distinguishes arithmetic geometry inside algebraic geometry is that we are mostly interested in fields K, which are arithmetically complex in the sense that the absolute Galois group, which I will denote by one of K here, is huge. So typically, arithmetically complex fields are fields of finite type over Q, or finite type over tendance degree one fields over FP. And so over such field, trying to compute the solution of a system of polynomial equation is basically impossible. So the way to try and understand such object is the solution proposed by arithmetic geometers is to consider not only the solution over K, but the solution over all subfield of K, and even over all K algebras. And this gives rise to the notion of arithmetic varieties, or affine arithmetic varieties more precisely, which are just functors from K algebras to sets, which to a K algebra A associate the set VA of solution of our polynomial equation with coefficient in A. So the set VA is, I will call it, the set of A points of the variety V. And in doing this, in particular, you can associate to your original problem a geometric object, which is a set of k-bar points of your variety. And with this, on this object, you can do algebraic geometry. But doing this, you don't lose really information about the original problem, because since the coefficients of your equations are in k, the Galois group of k acts naturally on the set of k-bar points. And you can recover the set of k points as being exactly the set of points which are fixed under the action of pi 1 of k. Okay, so that's a basic setting. And so the arithmetic geometry is governed by a general principle that which says that the geometry should control the arithmetic, and possibly the most elegant illustration of this principle is for curve. So if you have a curve, you can associate to it a numerical geometric invariant called the genus, which is a non-negative integer. So typically, if your field K is contained in C, you can look at the C points of your curve. This is a Riemann surface, and the genus is just a number of holes on this Riemann surface. And in 1983, Faltings proved what is called the Mordell conjecture, namely if K is a finite type over Q, as soon as the genus of your curve is larger than 2, you will have only finitely many K points. So as soon as your Riemann surface has at least 2 points, you will have only finitely many K points. And for the two remaining values of the genus, we also understand very well what happens. So in genus 0, if you have a k point, then the set of k points is basically in bijection with the one of the projective line. And in genus 1, if you have k points, then the set of k points has the structure of a finitely generated abelian group. And a curve of genus 1 with a k point is called an elliptic curve, so I will use this terminology later. You can even go further for curve. So, and consider another invariant called the geometric gonality, which is a positive integer. And the definition is quite simple. It is a minimal degree of a non-constant morphism from the variety, so pullback to the algebraic closure of K, to the projective line. And again, Faltings, 1 year later, he proved what was called the Mordell-Lang conjecture. So I will explain later in the talk what it is. But the consequence of this conjecture is that when K is a finite type over Q, and the gonality is larger than 2D plus 1, then you have only finitely many points with coordinates in a field of bounded degree d. So in the following, I will sometimes use this notation smaller than d to denote a set of points with coordinates in a field of degree at most d over the base field k.
And d is arbitrary.
D is arbitrary, yes. And so this is for curves. So for curves, we have really so the wonderful theorem of Faltings, which says that by simple numerical invariant, the genus and the gonality, we can distinguish classes of curves with very whose k points have really different behaviors. But then next, we may ask what happens for variety of dimension larger than 2, and so can we still define invariants controlling the structure of k points? So there, the question becomes really much more complicated, and we can say only a very few things about it. But however, one way to try and construct interesting invariant is to use algebraic cycles. So in fact, if you look at the k points on a curve, you can just identify them with some closed integral subvarieties of V defined over k. And algebraic cycles are just higher dimensional subvarieties of V, or rather a linear combination of them. So we define ZV, the abelian group of algebraic cycles. This is a graded group, and in degree I, this is just the Z combination, the free abelian group generated by the closed integral subvarieties of codimension I in V. So this is a very huge abelian group. And you would like to enrich this object by trying to encode in it the way subvarieties intersect. So the naive idea would be to define the product of two cycles as the sum over all irreducible components of the intersection. So this is unfortunately too naive to work as it is, but this idea will work if you mod out your original group, but what we call adequate equivalence relation, so typically rational equivalence. So I'm not going to define what it is, but the output, so I will actually look at this rather over Q, I will ignore torsion. The output is that you have a ring which encapsulates how a closed subvariety V intersect. So this contains lots of information in some sense about the arithmetic properties of your variety. And, but in some sense, it even contains too much information, because in general, this, for instance, is infinite dimensional, which for traditional arithmetic geometers makes it difficult to study. So to try and control, say something, however, about it, we can try and construct filtration on this ring with the property that the graded pieces are finite dimensional. So I'm insisting on finite dimensionality because when you are using Garrett's representation, in some sense, it's very difficult to say things for non-finite dimension, for infinite dimensional objects. So one way to construct such filtration is to use the fact that we have a cycle map from the Schering to Weyl cohomologies. So Weyl cohomologies are functors from varieties to finite dimensional F algebra. So here F is the field of characteristic zero. And these are endowed in general with additional structure. And the target category is the Tanakian category. So in particular, you can look at the algebra, the cohomology algebra of your variety, and look at the Tanakian category, subcategory generates. And this is equivalent to the category of representation of an algebraic group. So here I denoted by GHV, so it's naturally is a subgroup of the general linear group on the cohomology algebra. So it's an algebraic group over F, and we have to think about it as something measuring the complexity of our original variety. So in the following, I will call this group the motivic Garras group. It is this is a slight abuse of language, but if we believe in a whole set of deep conjectures, this should be the incarnation of the motivic Garras group dreamed by Grothendieck. In this talk, I will basically only focus on a special kind of wild cohomology called the Eladic cohomology. So here L is a prime which should be different from the characteristic of the base field K. And so the target category is the category of the Eladic cohomology, the category of QL, finite dimensional QL algebras endowed with the natural action of the absolute Garras group of K. And the image of the cycle map lies inside the Galois invariant part of the cohomology. And the motivic Galois group in this case is not very mysterious. It is just the RC closure of the image of the Galois representation on Eladic cohomology. And to give a concrete example, we can look at what happens for elliptic curves. So in that case, the connected component of the motivic Galois group can either be a rank 2 torus or a GL2. And the rank 2 torus corresponds to elliptic curves which have additional one additional endomorphism. So in some sense, the endomorphism, if you look at the graph, this is an algebraic cycle on the product V times V of your elliptic curves. So in some sense here, you see that the motivic Galois group detect this additional cycle. But also the Eladic cohomology is very far from exhausting, of course, the shoring, even in the case of elliptic curves. So here you have the cycle map from the shoring to the Eladic cohomology, which is image is just a two-dimensional vector space. And the kernel is the vector space generated by the group of k points of V, or more precisely of the dual of the dual elliptic curve, but it is isomorphic to V actually. As I mentioned that over a finitely generated field, this group of k points is always finitely generated, so the QL vector space is finite dimensional, but the dimension can be arbitrary, depending on the curves. I would also like to point out that this object, the kernel of the cycle map, is again related to a Galois representation on the Eladic cohomology, as follows. Actually, you can embed it into the first Galois cohomology group with value in the degree one part of the Eladic cohomology. So in the case of elliptic curve, it is quite easy to explain. The starting point is that if you look at the k-bar point of torsion of order exactly L to the n plus 1, of order, sorry, L to the power n plus 1, so this maps to the torsion of order L to the n by just multiplication. So this gives you a projective system structure on the group of Ln L to the n torsion points. And it happens that the first cohomology group, the degree one cohomology, can be described as a follow. You take the projective limit of this system. So this is a rank 2 ZL module, and you tensor by QL, and you get the first cohomology group. And now, to get the embedding, this embedding, you just start from the Kummer Isaac sequence given by multiplication by L to the n. So here I look at my varieties are as etal sheaf over K, if you want. And just you take the k-bar points, the pi 1 invariant, the projective limit, and tensor by QL, and you get this map as the first boundary map here. But much more generally, Tate and Janssen defined a kind of generalization of Eladic cohomology called continuous LID cohomology. And actually, the standard LID cohomology is a continuous LID cohomology of the geometric fiber of your variety. But anyway, so this continuous cohomology comes again with a cycle map and Hochschild spectral sequence which related to the standard LID cohomology. And this spectral sequence gives you a filtration on the target on the LID cohomology, and you can pull back this filtration by the cycle map to get what is called the LID Abel-Jacobi filtration. So this is a filtration by the sub vector space of your original show group. And the gradient part it are related to again to cohomology of to the cohomology of the Galois cohomology of the origin of the standard LID cohomology. So in some sense, using Galois representation, we can construct some invariant, some filtration on the show group, which capture a little more than just the image into the of the usual cycle map. So we have this Abel-Jacobi filtration. So it's but I should say that actually, so in the case of elliptic curve, it was quite simple. We just have two steps. But in general, very little is known currently about this filtration. One point, however, is that when k is finitely generated, we know that the image of the continuous cycle map is of finite dimension. So till you reach the kernel of the this cycle map, the gradient quotient are finite dimensional when your field is finitely generated. Okay. So the problem, so actually those invariants I have introduced, the motivic Galois group and the LID Abel-Jacobi filtration are very hard to compute in general. So the topics today is not really to try and compute them, but to try and understand how they vary in a given family.
So when you say that the image is finite dimensional, there is some question there, because the cycles are over these coefficients in the rationals and the cohomology is coefficient QL. So do you mean finite dimensional over Q, or that the QL space is?
I think I mean over QL.
That is that the QL span is finite dimensional.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Not that this, but the source could be maybe infinite dimensional.
I think the Q is not can be infinite dimensional.
So the filtration quotient itself over Q could be infinite.
Yes, you're right. Yeah. I mean QL. Yes, you're right. The gradient QL quotient. Yes, so I think the filtration over Q can be infinite dimensional. I think so. You're right. Unfortunately. So what I would like to discuss is rather the following problem. So we start with a variety over K, and we look at a family of variety parametrized by S. And I will denote by just VS, the fiber over a point S. And so the question is, how do those invariants, so the motivic Galois group, the show group, this is far too much, asking far too much, but at least the LID Abel-Jacobi quotient vary with S. So this is the main question. And for instance, if we keep on with the example of elliptic curves, so elliptic curves naturally live in a universal family over the projective line minus 3 points. So the question boils down to asking, if I have a point on the projective line, does what can I say about the set of points corresponding to CM elliptic curves? Or can I say something about the set of points with corresponding elliptic curves as a given rank?
So when you write elliptic Abel-Jacobi graded quotient, you mean the you can take the char group with coefficients in Q or with coefficients in QL? And then you get different things. Or you can take the QL span of this or
that. I think in the end, it won't matter for me, because I'm going to discuss about whether you have a natural map on the H1, so on the first, only on the, I can only say something about the zero and 1 degree cohomology part. And what I'm going to say is about the injectivity, so in some sense it. But I. I think the statement are actually over the Q part. So it's about infinite dimensional things, but it's about the injectivity of the specialization map.
So the Q, and this could be
infinite dimensional.
The Q subspace inside the Q vector space.
So yes, here it's a Q subspace. And so you're right. What I said about finite dimensional unity is not correct in the previous slide. So you're right. I'm pulling back the LADG Abel-Jacobi filtration on the Q showing, and the quotient are, as Q vector space are not finite dimensional. You're right. So one first remark is to, so it's easy to compare a numerical invariant like the genus of orthogonality. It's not as clear what it means to compare invariant like a Schwerin or a motivic Garas group. So the first remark is that thanks to a deep result about LADG cohomology, namely the smooth paper Bayes chance theorem, which was established by Grothendieck and his school in the mid-60s, we know that the LADG cohomology is constant in the fibers of a smooth projective family. So we can identify the LADG cohomology at a given fiber with the cohomology at the generic fiber, which is denoted with this eta. So I will just denote it by HL star now. And modulo this identification, you can show that the motivic Garas group at the special fiber, at a given fiber, always embed into the motivic Garas group at the generic fiber. So I will just denote this group by GL. And more concretely, you can see this also like this. So you have an action in your cohomology, you have an action of the absolute Garas group of, associated to your point, and an action of the generic absolute Garas group. And actually, the action of the generic absolute Garas group factors through the ethyl fundamental group of the base. So I'm going to say a few more words about this group later. And actually, the action of this group also factors through it. So you can really see via this diagram that the Zariski closure of the image of this representation is contained in the Zariski closure of the image of this representation. So that's a concrete way if you want to see this embedding. Anyway, so the question now becomes, what can we say about the exceptional locus, namely the set of point S, where the motivic Garas group at the fiber is strictly smaller than the motivic Garas group at the generic fiber. And actually, we'll only be able to say things about some kind of what I would call arithmetically a truncation of this exceptional locus. So meaning that, again, I will only look at points whose coordinates are of bounded degree d over the base field. And I would just like to recall that you have to think about this exceptional locus as the set of points where the fiber becomes, in some sense, simpler, in the sense that it has more algebraic cycles. So it's, I think it's a very natural object and question to study. Seemingly only very little is known about it. So I would like to mention that in the setting of singular cohomology, the similar question was basically answered by a famous theorem of Catani, Deligne, and Kaplan, which says that there the exceptional locus is a countable union of strict closed subvarieties. And I think this was predicted by the Hodge conjecture. Another remark is that if you believe in the Grothendieck-Sertet conjecture about LADG cohomology, the exceptional locus should be independent of L. Also, there is one setting in which we have a conjectural precise description of the exceptional locus. This is the one where you take for your family a universal abelian scheme over a Shimura variety. So in that case, the exceptional locus should be exactly the union of all the special subvarieties. And this would be should be a consequence of both the Hodge and the Tate conjecture. And a baby case of this example of universal abelian scheme over Shimura variety is the one of the universal elliptic curves over P1. So in that case, we can say a little more, since in that case, special subvarieties are exactly CM points. And Serre proved in 1968, so when he proved this open image theorem for elliptic curves, that so this is exactly the exceptional locus. And using the theory of complex multiplication and the standard theorem of algebraic number theory, you can prove in this in that case that the truncated exceptional locus are always finite. And now the main conjecture I would like to formulate about this problem is that what happens for elliptic curves should always hold in the following sense. Namely, if you have a finitely generated extension of Q, then I expect that the truncated arithmetic truncation of the exceptional locus is never the Heisky dance in S. So I will try and explain why I hope this conjecture is reasonable, at least for D is 1. That is, if you look at k rational points in the exceptional locus, possibly for D larger than 2, I don't have a really good reason to believe in it, except that what I'm going to explain now. So, I would like to give some results about this this problem, and the results will be basically limited to the case of curves, so when S is a curve. However, there is historically a result to mention, which is was proved independently and basically simultaneously by Serre and Terrasoma around the mid-80s, and which says that if K is Hilbertian, then you can always find an integer D such that you have points with coordinates of degree at most D which are not exceptional, and even you have infinitely many of them. So at least the exceptional locus in the case of Hilbertian field is not empty. That's something good. And so a few years ago, together with Tamagawa, we could extend and strengthen this theorem. As I said, when the base variety is a curve, is one-dimensional, and K is finitely generated extension of Q. So in that case, we showed that truncated, so the conjecture is true. So it is arithmetic truncation of the exceptional locus are always finite. And this result was extended recently by Emiliano Ambrosi to the case of finitely generated extension, infinite finitely generated extension of FP and the k-rational points. So one common feature of this result is, as I mentioned at the very beginning, that the fields here are arithmetically complex. They are very huge absolute Galois group. For a long time, until very recently, I thought that it would be impossible to say anything about other fields, because as you will see, the proof of this result is very is using strongly the assumptions, of course. But quite recently, working on a different, seemingly different problem, still with Tamagawa, we realized that for basically the fields which are opposite to those fields, namely finite fields, we could, however, say something. So, of course, if you consider, instead of a finitely generated field, you consider a finite field. So I recall that the absolute Galois group of a finite field is just procyclic, so it's very small. So in that case, the motivic Galois group at a special fiber will be abelian. So as soon as the one at the generic fiber is non-abelian, the exceptional locus will always be empty. So the original question posed that it is not very is not interesting in some sense. But what you can try and do is to measure what is so actually. Via Chevalet theorem, you know that an algebraic group is basically defined by the dimension of its invariant on all the tensor power of a given faithful representation. So here we have we can look at the invariant on the LAD cohomology, and also if we want at the on the tensor power of the LAD cohomology. And it is interesting to try and measure what is the maximal possible gap between the invariant of the motivic Galois group at the special fiber and at the generic fiber. And we realize that this is actually related to a kind of hidden motifs, which is given by the non-trivial zero weights of the representation of the geometric monodromy. So more precisely, if we denote by G bar, so the Zariski closure of the image of the geometric etal fundamental group, and by T bar, maximal torus unit. So I should mention that this G bar is known to be semi-simple at an algebraic group. Then you can define an invariant, mu naught, which is a multiplicity of the non-trivial zero weights. That is the dimension of the vector space, the T bar fixed vectors minus the dimension of the G bar fixed vectors. And it happens that this measures the maximal possible gap between the dimension of invariant and the special and generic fiber, in the sense that you only have a density, at most density zero set of points for which this gap is larger than this mu naught. So something, even when we specialize algebraic cycles to a finite Bass field, we cannot, everything cannot appear. And in particular, if you know that you have no non-trivial zero weight, so basically you, all the cycle as algebraic cycle as a special fiber comes from a generic one. So over a finite field, it's something a bit strange. Well, but anyway, this is just to say that with Galois representation techniques, we can even say things about a very small field. But I'm not going to say more about Theorem 2 in the following, because it uses very different techniques from Theorem 1, and the possibility is less emblematic of the general philosophy. So what I would like to explain briefly is the strategy of the proof of Theorem 1, and after that I would like to explain to use this strategy as the motivation for the main conjecture I formulated. So the basic idea is to start from the representation of the etal fundamental group of S and the Eladic cohomology. And to this, we can associate, so for the moment it's perhaps a little mysterious, but we can associate a tower of non-connected etal covers, which I call abstract modular schemes, so AMS for short, nothing you don't have to think about, just abstract modular schemes. And the property, so this tower has the property that if you look at, say, k-rational points, projective system of k-rational points along this tower, and you look at the image of those projective system, you exactly get the k-points in the exceptional locus. And this works also if you take points with a coordinate of bounded degree by d. So this motivates the terminology modular, in abstract modular schemes. And suppose that you can show that the genus of those curves, so suppose that S is a curve, so all the Sn are curves, and suppose that you can show that the genus of those curves become larger than 2 for n large enough, then using a model conjecture, this proved by Faltings, this implies that for n large enough, you will have only finitely many k-rational points on your tower. And so, tautologically, the image of the set of k-points in the exceptional locus, thanks to this, will be finite. And you can also, if you want to control set points of with coordinate of bounded degree, you can try and replace the genus by the gonality. And using Mordell Lang, this will again give you the conclusion. So the proof, the strategy is very quite simple, I think. But of course, the difficulty is where I wrote AD. So AD is for Adamelian dictionary. So the problem is to try and construct this tower first, and then to show that the genus or the geometric gonality tends to infinity. And for me, I call this kind of constructing an Adamelian dictionary in the sense that we really have to understand how the representation theoretic properties of rho are related, intertwined with the arithmetico-geometric property of the abstract modular schemes. So this uses a mix of techniques from both representation theory and arithmetico-geometry. So I'm not going to give lots of detail, but however, I would like to give you a flavor of how it looks. So first, I would like to recall briefly some things about the etal fundamental group. So of course, the etal fundamental group is an analog of the usual topological fundamental group you know for topological spaces. And you have to think of it as a generalizing. So if you have a topological space, the finite quotient of the topological fundamental group controls the finite topological covers. And it's exactly the same for the étale fundamental group. Namely, if you look at the category of étale cover of S, and if you fix a point, so a geometric point, you can look at the fiber over this point. So this gives you a functor. And the étale fundamental group is defined as the automorphism group of this functor. So it is naturally a profinite group, and it induces an equivalence between the category of étale cover of S and the category of finite set equipped with a continuous section of the étale fundamental group. And in particular, if you take an open subgroup of U of your fundamental group, then the quotient gives you a finite set equipped with a continuous section of pi 1. And so by this equivalence of categories, this corresponds to an étale cover of S. And a key property for us, which is just a formal consequence of the formalism of Galois categories, is that if you look at the image of the étale fundamental group is functorial, so if I take a point, I can just look at it as a zero-dimensional subvariety of S, so I have a natural map, I have already mentioned it, from the pi 1 of the point to the pi 1 of S, and the image of this map is contained in a group U, in an open subgroup U, if and only if the point lifts to a point with the same coordinates on the étale cover. So this gives a way to translate some group theoretic properties into properties of rational points. So this is a key ingredient in the philosophy. Now, how can we apply this? So maybe before explaining the proof of theorem 1, I can try and explain the proof of Serre and Terrasoma, so the first proposition I mentioned. So for this, you start from a LHC representation of the étale fundamental group. So I denote by pi L the image. And the key point is that when you have an LHC Lie group, such group has the property that what we call the Frattini subgroup, which is defined as the intersection of all the maximal open subgroup of the group. This Frattini subgroup is open. And in particular, if you want to show that, if now I take a point, and if I want to show that the representation I obtain by composing the map from pi 1 of the point to pi 1 of S and then to pi L is surjective, this amounts to showing that the map to the quotient of pi L by the Frattini subgroup is still surjective. But now, so this also means that I have to show that the image is not contained in any intermediate subgroup, which are always open because the Frattini subgroup is open. And then this, by what I have explained just before, can be translated by saying that S does not lift to a point with the same coordinate on the cover S phi, which is defined just as the disjoint union of the cover corresponding to the inverse image of the group U. And these are only finitely many ones, so this is a non-connected étale cover of S. And the conclusion of Serre-Terrasoma argument is just a consequence of the property of Hilbertian fields, which always ensures, so being Hilbertian always ensures that there exists an integer D with the property that you have points with coordinates of degree at most D on over S, which are not in the image of this map. Okay. So that's an event you have infinitely many ones. So this is the strategy, the basic strategy. And this, in some sense, inspires a little the construction of the tower of abstract modular scheme SN. So again, we start with the representation. Something I should say is that actually what we are not, it's very important in Serre and Terrasoma's argument that we are working over K. In the setting of theorem 1, we are actually working over the algebraic closure of K. So I don't mention it, but here I have base change actually to the algebraic closure of K. We still start with the LHC representation. So actually it lives in the general linear group over the LHC homology, which is a QL vector space. But as the étale fundamental group is a profinite group, it is compact. And I can always assume that it has value in the automorphism group of ZL lattice, so this lambda L is a ZL lattice. And I define pi ln to be the kernel of the reduction modulo ln map. So this is an open subgroup of pi L. And then the good definition, so it's not necessary to really read all the things, so it's not really important, but the good definition of the abstract modular scheme is given here by this. So we have to introduce a certain carefully chosen collection of open subgroup, which is a finite collection, and we define a little in the same way the abstract modular schemes, and we have a projective system structure on it. Okay. So the technical definition is not very important. The strategy of the proof, that's the construction of the tower of abstract modular schemes. Next, we have to show that the genus or the gonality goes to infinity, so I'm not going to say anything about the gonality. But for the genus, basically the proof is in two steps. The first step is to replace this cover Sn by its Galois closure and to show that the genus of the Galois closure turns to infinity. So this uses the classification of finite automorphism groups of small genus curves. And here we need an assumption, which I will explain in the next slide. So this is in some sense the only place where we need an assumption. All the other parts are formed. Basically, we just need a LADIC representation. So in the argument of Serre and Terrasoma, we were just starting from any LADIC representation. Here we are starting also from any LADIC representation with this assumption, which I will explain. And once you have proved that the genus of the Galois closure tends to infinity, then the second step is to compare the genus of the Galois closure with the genus of Abbot curves by Riemann-Hurwitz formula. And here comes a very technical step, which is we have to estimate the size of the ramification terms, if you want, in terms of number of points on reduction modulo ln of certain LADIC homogeneous space related to the representations. And for this, we need to use some asymptotic bounds for such reduction modulo L proved by Serre and Osterling. So here you see, just to explain how, in some sense, representation theory is intertwined with arithmetic geometry to prove such a theorem. So as you see from the proof, so very little about the original input is used, except so that we have a LADIC representation. And actually, theorem 1 is a special case of a more general theorem, which we call the uniform open image theorem, which, as I said, holds for any LADIC representation of the pi 1 of a curve, provided the base field is finitely generated. So the assumption finitely generated, I should perhaps insist again on this, comes from the use of the results of Altings. I have used Mordell conjecture and Mordell Lang, and this is where it's really important that the base field be finitely generated. And to such a representation, we can associate an exceptional locus, which is a set of points where the image of the local Galois group is not open in the image of the generic Galois group. And then the general theorem is that under the GLP assumption, so still this mysterious assumption, you always have the finiteness of the truncated exceptional locus, and you have more, which justifies the uniform open image theorem, namely if you take a point with bounded degree coordinate, but not in the exceptional locus, then the index of the image of the local representation in the index of the generic one is always uniformly bounded by something which only depends on D. And so the GLP condition basically means, so I have written something between commas, so it means roughly that the image of the geometric étale fundamental group has no abelian quotients. So the precise definition is just that the Lie algebra of the image is perfect. And so to apply this theorem to the concrete case of representation and LADIC homology, you just have to check the GLP condition. And so the GLP condition is implied by the semi-simplicity of the representation of the geometric étale fundamental group. And for a smooth projective family, this semi-simplicity is ensured by the result of Deligne in Weyl 2, the weight theory of Deligne. So I would like to, before coming back to the main conjecture, I would like to give a sample of applications of this very of this general theorem. So there is basically I have organized this application in three kinds. So the first kind of application is of this exactly the same kind as the one for Motivic Galois group. Actually, well, I don't want to explain really, but the degeneration of Motivic Galois group as I described them is very related to the degeneration of Motivic Galois group in the sense of André. So for those who know, if we have the degeneration of the Motivic Galois group of André, we automatically have the degeneration of the Eladic Motivic Galois group. So in particular, for these groups, we have also sparsity of the degeneration locus. And the special case of this are that we can, so we have a finiteness of the jumping locus of the rank of Néron Severi groups or of the rank of endomorphism rings of abelian varieties. When you have a one-dimensional family of varieties or abelian varieties. And so this first kind of applications only use the finiteness of the truncated exceptional locus. The second kind of application uses a refined part about the uniformity of outside the exceptional locus. And using this, we can obtain uniform bounds, for instance, for the L primary torsion in a one-dimensional family of abelian varieties. So the only known case before our result was due to Manin and goes back at least I think to 1969, and we could also apply this to the uniform boundedness of the L primary part of Brouwer groups, and before that only there were only a very few results in the special case of K3 surfaces for Bayes, Korobogatov, and Zarin. And a third kind of application, which is for non-semi-simple but still GLP representation, is to the Eladic Abel-Jacobi filtration, which I have introduced with some work before. And actually, we can say only very little about it, but still, I hope something new, namely that if you look at the first graded part of the Eladic Abel-Jacobi filtration at the generic and special fiber, it is not obvious at all that the rank doesn't that the specialization map is injective, and we can prove that as outside the exception, so the finite set of points, it is always injective. And a very special case of this is when you consider the rank of abelian varieties, and this result for abelian varieties was known for number field and was proved by Silverman in 1983. But here we have something much more general, and actually what we control is the injectivity of the specialization map for one co-cycles. So when you have a H1, actually you have a kind of universal representation to which we can apply the uniform open image theorem. So here I have just encapsulated some results, maybe a more concrete theorem about families of abelian variety, which is a special case of one and two here. So if you have a finitely generated extension of Q, a curve S over K, and a family of abelian variety parametrized by S, in this case, so our result says that L primary torsion is uniformly bound in the fibers for points with bounded degree residue field. And for all but finitely many such points, rank here's the inequality in the opposite sense. The rank of the abelian variety at the special fiber is always larger or equal to the rank of the abelian variety at the generic fiber. So here there's some mistakes. It's larger than equal that you have to write, to read. Okay, and in the 5 minutes left, I would like... I have another application, but this is very quick. One thing which is also worth noticing is that I have mentioned what I can say, just we can just control invariant attached to Eladic cohomology. But actually, so this is cohomology with QL coefficient, and we have so this LADIC exceptional locus, and we can associate to it. But we could also try and say something about, look at all the LADIC cohomology for all L together. This gives you a kind of cohomology with adelic coefficient. And if you are in positive characteristic, there is L has to be different from P, so there is something missing. But you have some cohomology with p-adic coefficient too. And one application of the sparsity result of the exceptional locus is that it can transfer automatically to p-adic and adelic coefficient, at least in some case. So actually, for adelic coefficient, in general, we just know this inclusion. And we do not know if the exceptional locus is non-empty in general. Actually, this should follow from some variant modulo L of the Tate, or rather the Grothendieck-Tate conjecture. But we can prove this in some very special case, namely when for representation attached to abelian varieties or most Shimura varieties, because we have this Tate conjecture modulo L, or almost it. And we can also, and we can also transfer automatically sparseness result from L-adic to p-adic coefficient using techniques from Langlands, and in particular the p-adic Langlands correspondence of AB. Okay, so now I'm coming back to the main conjecture. So I recall the statement in a possibly slightly more general setting, so just a setting of L-adic representation of variety over a finitely generated field extension of Q. So to this, I can associate my exceptional locus, and the conjecture says that, so here I formulate the conjecture over K, because as I said, for truncated for extension of degree at most D, I'm not sure it is really reasonable. But for if you look at the K rational points of the exceptional locus, so the conjecture says that it shouldn't be the risky dense. And now, if you recall the basic strategy of the proof of theorem 1, which was a proof of the conjecture for when S is a curve, there is two steps where we use that we have a curve, namely when we use a genus invariant, which is specific to curves, and when we use a model conjecture. So unfortunately, there is no model analog of the model conjecture for higher dimensional varieties, but there is a conjecture. So there is a conjecture, but it's not a theorem. It's called the Lang conjecture, and it says that if you replace being of genus larger than 2 by being of general type, then the set of k-points should not be the Zariski dense. So I'm not going to explain exactly what being of general type means. It means that you have an invariant, the Codemara dimension, which should be equal to the dimension of your variety. But for curves, being of general type exactly means being of larger exactly means being of genus larger than 2. And being not Zariski dense for a curve just means to be finite. So for S of dimension 1, the Lang conjecture is exactly the model conjecture. But unfortunately, this conjecture is widely open for higher dimension, and I think that arithmetic geometers are divided into two classes, those who believe in Lang conjecture and those who don't believe in Lang conjecture. But, so it is known, however, in one case, the case of subvarieties of abelian varieties, and this is the model Lang conjecture, and this was proved by Faltin. So this is to explain the terminology model Lang at the beginning of the talk. But anyway, so this is the conjecture which basically motivates my conjecture about the sparsity of the k-points in the exceptional locus, because if you can prove at least that the for higher dimensional base S, the Sn are of general type for n large enough, then modulo the Lang conjecture, you would have our original this conjecture about the sparsity of the exceptional locus just by the same kind of argument. Of course, this is a priori very hard to prove, but there's some hope at least, and this is a very natural question. And what I would like also, and I will conclude with this, to point out is that actually we need much less than the Lang conjecture. I just need to know that if I look at k-rational projective system of k-rational points, the image of those are not the Zariski dense. So I don't know if it is reasonable to try and formulate a weak form of long conjecture, namely if you have a tower of etal covers which becomes of general type for n large enough, then could we prove that maybe at every level the set of k points is still Zariski dense, but if we look at the image of all projective systems in the base variety, it's no longer Zariski dense. So I do not know if it is reasonable. I don't even know. I think that one first question, interesting question, it would be to try and prove this wake form for S of dimension 1, not using, of course, model conjecture by some methods which are likely to extend to higher dimensional Bayes schemes. So one idea would be to look at the p-adic motivic approach of Kim to model conjecture, which.
But I don't understand weak Lang, because you can take a constant, if this is true, you can take a constant tower where Sn is the same, the general type for all n large enough.
That's true, okay. I have to modify the statement of the weak. Say with such that the corresponding image of the etal fundamental group is big enough, like GLP or, yeah, you have to make, you're right. So maybe the good exercise is, I don't know. What are the conditions you have to put on the tower so that the conclusion holds? No, but you're right, of course. So.
Maybe. You finish?
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Are there any questions, comments? It's okay?
No, just to make precise this exceptional locus, because you in the argument with Hilbert irreducibility, it seems that you look at the exceptional locus in the sense of the points where the Galois group. So you have the points where the dimension of the Zariski closure drops, and the points where the Zariski closure drops, which is, so it is possible the Zariski closure is not connected. So I believe that what you prove in theorem one is for the set where the dimension of the Zariski closure drops. Is it correct?
So
in theorem one, the exceptional set is the set of points in capital S such that the Zariski closure of the Galois group in the
dimension drops. Yeah,
the dimension drops. This
yes,
is the definition.
Yes, that's it. Yeah.
Okay. But you wrote something like just that the group is smaller.
Not open.
Ah, not open.
Yes, yeah. But okay. Actually, for motivic representation, we know that the image of the Galois representation is always open in the ZL points on the size closure. That's not trivial, that's the Hochstede property of motivic representations. So the for a general LADIC representation, the good definition of the exceptional locus is that the image is not open in the generic image. But for motivic representation, both exceptional locus coincides.
Okay, maybe I will ask.
Yeah, okay.
Any other question? Yeah, so this is an argument for natural point. So if you want to study a bounded degree,
you expect to have some heuristic argument.
You mean for bounded degree and
yeah,
not for k points?
Yeah, yeah.
No, actually, I don't have. This is why I said this is. We can prove it for curves, but I don't see how to extend, for instance, Falting's argument to higher dimensional. So this is why I wrote it possibly too optimistic. But
okay. Yeah. Thank you.
More question? Okay, so thank you. Thanks to the speaker again.